to be elated tonight. The reason? They believe they are eliminating something that has been a real political troublemaker to them, unemployment.
And those aren't the only numbers getting smaller. Add to your list the life expectancy of this program. Stay tuned to the end because there is many a surprise ahead for this edition, number 367, the final edition of Overnight.
Some people think that in journalism, good news is no news. Not true. News is news without the judgment call. And so it is with pleasure we begin tonight's broadcast with good news. Unemployment in the United States is the lowest it's been in 2 years. Sales of new houses are up, and new orders to factories for manufactured goods are up. None of this is as good as it ought to be, but it sure is better than it has been, and that's a fact. Here are some more from economics correspondent Irving R. Levine.
Almost three-quarters of a million Americans, roughly the population of San Antonio or Indianapolis, found jobs last month. From 10.8% unemployment last December, a slide to 8.4%. Dramatic and unexpected. Even President Reagan, speaking to a student group, admitted surprise, saying that the November rate was...
What we had predicted would be true in the end of 1985. So we're a little ahead of schedule.
Adult men got the biggest share of the new jobs. The same group was hardest hit by layoffs. At Firestone Tire, Tom Wyman was rehired after 2 years without work.
Make this Christmas a lot better than it has been the last couple.
In some places, the weather helped. Early snows in Colorado. Ski resorts hired earlier than usual.
We put on approximately 45 additional people other than our normal summer crew.
But factories accounted for most of the new jobs, particularly in autos, 74% more cars being produced than a year ago.
We plan to increase the plant's workforce by some 1,200 people.
Even so, almost 9.5 million Americans can't find work. 2,000 of them have applied for jobs at a soon-to-be-completed Washington hotel.
I had a summer job, and that was it. And I'm ready to get back to work.
More Americans working and paying taxes instead of drawing unemployment benefits could help bring down the federal deficit and keep interest rates from rising. And if the trend continues, it could pull the rug out from under Democrats, who thought President Reagan would be vulnerable for his handling of the economy. Irving R. Levine, NBC News, Washington.
And then there are the 9.4 million people who are still out of work. Recent studies indicate there's not much hope for putting the economic rug back under many of them. They are the so-called new poor, those affected by the decline of industry. How to find new jobs for them is a major problem. The alternative is welfare. A better alternative comes to us from Florida. The reporter is Dave Frankel of WSVN, Miami.
It could be the grill in any short-order restaurant, but it happens to be the trolley snack shop in Medley. A run-of-the-mill diner in every respect but one. It's owned and operated by the town.
Everyone felt it was a good thing because, people need jobs. So we felt that instead of handing them welfare or something like that, people don't want welfare, they like to work.
And that's why the trolley snack shop was opened last Valentine's Day, to provide jobs for the unemployed people of Medley. People like Patty Silvers, who was skeptical of the mayor's idea.
But when he first talked to me, you know, it was, okay, it's going to open this week, it's going to open next week, it's going to... So I really didn't think, you know, that it would open.
And now here it is. Now what do you think?
It's great.
I told him I needed a job, and he said, would I like it permanently? I go, yeah, and he goes, well, you know how to cook? And I said, well, I've cooked for myself. He said, that's all you need to know. We'll teach you the rest.
The work is part-time, four-hour shifts. Employees earn about $5 an hour plus tips. The profits, which are just starting to come in, are plowed right back into the restaurant. Townspeople and customers love the idea.
Good food, nice people, friendly atmosphere. You know, it's just a nice place. It's the best place around.
Best and getting better, the employees say. Next on the menu here, an expansion, a bigger kitchen, and most importantly for the unemployed here in town, more jobs. In Medley, Florida, Dave Frankel for NBC News.
Their alternative comes to us from
bigger kitchen, and most importantly for the unemployed here in town, more jobs. In Medley, Florida, Dave Frankel for NBC News.
A Christmas gift from Radio Shack.
I was looking for a gift for the whole family, and I found this Radio Shack cordless phone on sale for $99.95. It has auto redial, a privacy button, and you just plug it in. We can make calls from almost anywhere, the kitchen, the bedroom, even out in the back porch. With no monthly telephone rental charges, we save. They'll never guess what I got them.
The cordless phone on sale for $99.95, only at Radio Shack.
Why do you insist on Preparation H?
The fact that Preparation H is recommended by doctors makes me feel secure with the product. If, in fact, they would recommend it, I never will use another product but Preparation H.
Doctor-recommended Preparation H often gives temporary relief from pain and itch flare-ups, even helps shrink swelling of inflamed hemorrhoidal tissues.
The pain, the itching, and the swelling all went away. The fact that it is recommended by doctors does make a difference.
Preparation H relieves pain and itch, even helps shrink swelling.
The West has always been a place where a man went to prove himself. This spirit has been captured in Chaps, the cologne by Ralph Lauren. Chaps isn't just for men who ride horses. It's for men everywhere who are strong and proud, who are living their lives with a feeling of independence. Chaps, the cologne by Ralph Lauren. The spirit of the West that's everywhere today.
The way some business people spend their time has very little to do with a clock. At Apple, we understand that business as usual isn't anymore. That's why we make the most advanced personal computers in the world. And why soon there'll be just two kinds of people.
Hi.
Those who use computers.
Yeah, I'll be home for breakfast.
And those who use apples.
Friday, El Salvador's defense minister issued his government's sharpest condemnation yet of rightist death squads. He said the people of El Salvador should turn the death squads in. He said the death squads' existence is a threat to democracy. That's not all the death squads threaten. They also threaten continued United States military aid. The minister picked an interesting day to speak up. It was the third anniversary of the murder of four American church women in El Salvador. And we will have the report NBC News ran that day. And while you watch, two things to think about. First, despite an apparently strong case, the El Salvadoran government has not tried the five accused murderers. And second, the defense minister had absolutely nothing to say about that on Friday.
Today from El Salvador in Central America that four Americans have been killed there, shot to death and buried. A justice of the peace identified the bodies today, three Roman Catholic nuns and a woman social worker. The women had been missing since Tuesday. They were last seen riding in a van on the way into town from the airport. Phil Bremen picks up the story there.
The burned-out van in which the women had been riding was found on a lonely stretch of road not far from El Salvador's international airport. Sister Dorothy Kazel, along with lay volunteer Jean Donovan, both of Cleveland, Ohio, had gone to the airport to pick up two other nuns. Sister Eta Ford, along with Maura Clark, both of New York City, were returning to El Salvador from a meeting in Nicaragua. From missions like this one at La Libertad, they taught about religion and more.
About basic human rights, about the dignity, your human dignity, the necessity of having enough to eat.
It's because of human rights teachings, the acting Archbishop of El Salvador said that 10 priests, including his predecessor, have been murdered. He said the four women in this van were the first religious workers from North America to become apparent targets of political violence. The American priest who runs the mission at La Libertad said all four, including the two he supervised, had seen violence and suffering among the people here.
That both of them have kept a very strong spirit and optimistic spirit that we can help them and we will stay and help them the best we can.
In the struggle for power here, both left and right burn, kidnap, and kill. But only the right has threatened the clergy for the ideas they spread, ideas that go against the historic domination of this impoverished country by a privileged few. Phil Brennan, NBC News, La Libertad, El Salvador.
The leadership of any country, wants to be seen as it wants to be seen. That is not a sin, but it's something to know and to remember. And it's something that makes covering the White House a curious job. That is why presidents like what is called a photo opportunity, which is nothing more than a lack of opportunity to do anything other than take a photograph. No questions, no answers. What follows is from NBC White House correspondent Andrea Mitchell. She doesn't hate Mr. Reagan. She isn't out to get him. She is, professionally, out to get the story. It's her job. At the White House, any White House, that's not very easy to do, especially when he has more experience with cameras than you do.
Not looking for trouble. Don't aim to cause any. I got business in town. Important business.
I came from an industry in which ham is the basic ingredient. Now, you know what a ham is in our business. This is an actor you don't have to egg on.
Or a president. All politicians do silly things like this, but no one has done it as naturally as Ronald Reagan. Or as often.
Mr. President, can you do a sandbag on the inside?
What should I do? One more.
That's your direction.
If his handlers tell him to fill sandbags at a flood, he does. He's the public relations president, the master of the photo opportunity. Driving a tractor in Peoria beats trying to explain unemployment. Sometimes it backfires. This stop in Boston was supposed to appeal to working class voters until the president ruined his blue collar image by suggesting that the corporate income tax be repealed. Reporters did ask about that, and the president's spokesman said, "Don't tell us how to stage the news, and we won't tell you how to cover it." But still, you begin to wonder, is there any there? Or is there a life after the photo op?
17 inches.
Do we have a president or an actor playing commander-in-chief? No one is better at delivering a set speech. With a teleprompter, he can explain arms control. But without a script, the stuff gets awfully complicated.
I don't know, but what, maybe you haven't gotten into the area that I'm going to turn over to the, to the Secretary of Defense.
The silence will be hard.
Yes.
How much does he know? Privately, his aides say not very much. He's smart, they say, but lazy. When he does try to explain things, they try to cut him off.
Might be well to point out that the increase in defense spending, we have more than cut in half. The increase over the
or projected, find a way to take our eye off the ball.
And we are holding it to 7%.
Not one of the finer moments in journalism. When the networks complained about being tricked into carrying a not very newsworthy event, one White House official grumbled, they want to run their game shows instead of our game shows.
Stand by your bed.
For an even lighter touch, the White House turns occasionally to entertainers. Show business meets show business. When all else fails, the show goes on the road. But next time, let him get some rest. That was only a warm-up for the greatest staged event of all time. The Gipper staring down the commies at the DMZ. It also gave him a chance to take a shot at the scene below. The North Korean outpost, the GIs call Propaganda Village.
Looks like a Hollywood back lot. And isn't any more important.
Unlike the White House back lot, as the man said, you know what ham is in our business.
You will never see me hit another puck again. As well as that.
Andrea Mitchell, NBC News at the White House.
More on your government in action. Have you ever wondered why the call letters of radio and TV stations are so, well, clean? Why are there no racy combinations of those four letters that begin with either K or W and identify the stations? Because the Federal Communications Commission prohibited it until Friday. That was the day the FCC voted to stop regulating what a station may call itself. A check of the book shows that KAKA, Kaka Radio in Dermot, Arkansas, and WHIP, Whip Radio in Mooresville, North Carolina, are taken. Many other neat four-letter words are not. Be advised. There was more news Friday, and here is some of it, tastefully presented on a reel.
the second time in a week this has happened in the Los Angeles area. Someone firebombed the home of a Continental Airlines employee who was working in spite of the strike. The woman who lives there and her children were unharmed. The same is not so of her home.
The estimated damage at this point in time would be approximately $40,000 to the structure and about $15,000 to the contents itself.
Constant viewers will recall this scene. It's the world champion tire fire started by arsonists last Halloween and burning ever since at a dump near Winchester, Virginia. They could put it out, and for a while, local firemen worked on it. But after a few weeks, the Environmental Protection Agency said it wasn't a good plan. Instead, they'd rather let it blaze away under controlled conditions. That's because the water they've poured on is a bigger pollution hazard than the burning tires, so they've decided to contain the mess, let it burn. It could go for a year.
Friday night in Los Angeles, in the high school football playoffs, Norbun played Birmingham. Norbun played without its usual quarterback. He was sidelined because he failed algebra. In Los Angeles, you have to have a C average and no failing grades in order to play football. That rule will be reconsidered in the spring because the coaches don't like it. The teachers do.
The classroom is the focal point of school, not the football field, not the basketball court, not the stage. Classroom.
The writing that just went off the screen said stairs for sale in French. Indeed, they are French stairs for sale. They used to be the spiral staircase of the Eiffel Tower. Now they've been replaced and carefully removed, section by section. In Paris Friday, they were auctioned. Among the buyers, Disney World and the folks renovating the Statue of Liberty. The money will go to fix up the tower. The 20 sections sold Friday brought $225,000.
Adjugé 180 000.
A factory in Hong Kong is going day and night to produce 200,000 cabbage patch dolls a week for America. But in Hong Kong, do they care about those dolls? Correspondent George Lewis and Doll hung out on the street to find out. Or in George's case, to meet new friends.
They're not available in the stores. I got this one from the factory.
Where's the factory? How do we get there? Take us there.
Sounds great. How much?
$99.
That's better than $300 through the school.
We'll also give you $100 worth of music free and a buyback plan.
Sold!
Used band instruments start at $59. New ones from $149. There's no sales tax, and we'll give you free music books too. Hampshire Music Company is on Route 101A in Nashua, New Hampshire.
It's the cashmere sweater. Looks expensive, but I paid only $59.75 at Burlington Coat Factory. Only $59.75 for 100% cashmere. Burlington made a fantastic buy from a very famous maker, so I got a fantastic buy. Had my pick of V-neck, crew neck, turtleneck, cowl neck. Bought one of each. At $59.75, who could resist? Burlington Coat Factory, a girl's best friend. Next to diamonds, of course.
Why Children's Hospital?
At emergency, I'd come to Children's Hospital.
Because I know I'll get help immediately. I have the best doctors, and I get answers to all my questions.
Because one thing I notice about Children's is that if I have a case of emergency, the doctor is always on hand, and they can always answer my questions, and they take really good care of the babies here.
Well, I'm a medical student working there for this month. And I'm finding that it's a wonderful place where the nurses and the doctors and all the staff really care about the children.
I always think of Children's Hospital first because I think they do a great job and they give a good treatment. And the nurses are great, and I think it's the perfect place to go when your child is sick.
Join us. We need your help. Contribute to Children's Hospital Fund, Box 1983, Cambridge, Mass. 02238.
By one definition, immortality is when they talk about you after you're gone. Well, that's nice. Only one thing better than that, not going at all. But since going is inevitable, also inevitable, our fascination with the last message sent before the power was turned off. It can be very revealing. So, let's gather around the video campfire as the Not Ready for Primetime News tells the bedside stories of those who've gone before. Producer Kathy Porter and videotape editor Connie Goetsch has put this together. To put you in the mood, the exit line of French composer Paul Claudel, who said, "Doctor, do you think it could have been the sausage?"
So I just want to say...
Not now, Mary. The news is on.
Last night, as I lay awake in my bed, I wondered, how do I tell these dear friends and colleagues how I feel about them? How, I wondered, do you speak from here instead of here? I think what I was feeling was best expressed in the lyrics of that wonderful old song. It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. This is Tut Baxter saying good night and good news.
Tipperary.
Now then, Gene Shalit. We are in the public garden, right opposite the Boston Common in Boston, with the swan boats right behind us. So now, repeat after me. Boston.
Boston.
Garden.
Garden.
Common.
Common. Barbara, incidentally, is on tape this morning for her final appearance with us here on the Today program.
I love you all. I will miss you all. This is Barbara Walters on the Today Show in Massachusetts.
NBC Magazine with David Brinkley.
The first news story I ever wrote on a small town newspaper was two sentences long, and the big news in it was that the city of Wilmington, North Carolina was about to repaint the stripe down the middle of 3rd Street. Two sentences. Probably should have been one. Well, NBC has made it possible for me to do whatever I have done since then, and wherever I wind up working, and I will work on the air, I will always be grateful for that.
His name is Lloyd Dobbins.
Her name is Linda Ellerbe.
Good night, Lloyd.
Good night, Linda. This is our last program. Weekend has been canceled. It has been fun. It is now over. And so it goes. For Reuben, Frank, Linda, and me, keep the faith. Enjoy your weekends. Weekend will not be back.
At the risk of sounding presumptuous, I would say to all of you, be patient and have courage, for there will be better and happier news one day if we work at it.
I really don't want to say it, but the time has come, and so for the last time, good luck and good night, Chet.
Good luck, David, and good night for NBC News.
Tipperary, it's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Cricket Dinnerly. Farewell, Leicester Square. It's a long, long way to Tipperary, and bye.
A Christmas gift from Radio Shack.
I finally found a way to talk to my kids this Christmas. I gave them Radio Shack Space Patrol walkie-talkies. They're terrific outdoor fun. They have flexible antennas to withstand rugged use and built-in Morse code keys with the code alphabet on the front so they can talk or send messages in code. Kids got walkie-talkies, and so did I. Okay, troops, time for lunch.
Space Patrol walkie-talkies, $9.95, only at Radio Shack.
There's a lot of this ahead, so now's the time to buy a dependable Chamberlain garage door opener.
Just push a button from your car and let a Chamberlain light your way for safety and security. So enjoy the convenience of a Chamberlain garage door opener, and if you buy before Christmas, Chamberlain will send you the second transmitter free, a $29.95 retail value. See your Chamberlain dealer now and get a free second transmitter worth $29.95.
Don't miss out on this great free offer. See your Chamberlain garage door opener dealer today.
Hello. I like this Remington Microscreen rechargeable shaver so much, I bought the company. It shaves as close as a blade, or I'll give you your money back. The first Microscreen is so thin, it shaves incredibly close. The second, even closer. And Remington's American-made. It costs less. Norelco's imported. It costs much more. The Remington Microscreen rechargeable shaver shaves as close as a blade, or your money back.
And the Lady Remington rechargeable, the perfect gift, shaves without a cord.
Saturday, could Kimberly be in trouble?
Oh, no.
Is the store going to drop a load here?
Find out on Different Strokes. Next, it's Menudo Madness when Ricky recruits the Rockers on Silver Spoons. And it's a Manimal Rescue when Jonathan enters a high-flying race to save Brooke's life. Then Big Bad John bucks the Big Apple baddies. When Dale Robertson and Joey Travolta star in an all-new special drama beginning at 8, 7 Central and Upton on NBC.
Be there.
Well, wouldn't you know, sports talk fans, tonight's lead story is about Billy Martin, three-time manager of the New York Yankees. The New York Post reports that Martin may be on his way out again. Gentle George Steinbrenner spent 90 minutes with Yogi Berra, who managed the Yankees back in 1964. Said Berra, he asked me if I was interested, and I told him I was. Is Steinbrenner about to fire Martin again? Said Berra, George didn't say he was letting Billy go, but he didn't say he wasn't. Seems like this is where we came in. The final scores now on the ultimate roll. And it's Jan Ludwig, that New Jersey Devil, scoring in the first period against Washington. Here comes a save by the Washington goalie, but Hector Marini scores his first goal since last year's All-Star game. Late in the third period, Washington's Mike Gartner tied the game with a 45-foot shot. It stayed tied. Now for overnight overtime, the preliminary bout between Pat Verbeek and Bobby Gould. That was followed by Joe Cirella and Dave Shand in the main event. With all that fighting and waltzing around, nobody had time to score, so nobody won. Isn't that too bad and too typical?
One of the job titles here is editor. It means writing and cutting pieces. Pat Tracy's got that job, or that's what they pay him for. And for the past 17 months, part of the job has been writing and editing sports. We call it sports talk. They are the only words that Linda and I speak that we don't write ourselves. But Pat's real job here is to be wise. Every newsroom needs such a person, but few are so lucky as we. Pat's got some things to say about sports, so tonight, instead of a sports feature, we feature Pat.
It all began, as Ted Baxter once said, a little 50,000-watt NBC radio station in Cleveland, Ohio. I turned 21 and got a job writing for the late Tom Manning, the dean of the nation's sportscasters. Tom had started out announcing the starting lineups for the Indians at League Park with a megaphone. Later, he was second man to Graham McNamee for the first coast-to-coast radio broadcast of the World Series and the Rose Bowl. That's the man who taught me to write sports talk, one of the very first in the business. He taught me some other things about sports, too, that despite what the modern sports talkers tell you, winning isn't everything. If Billy Martin's job is up for grabs tonight, it's because the Yankees finished third, not first this year. And if amateur athletes are in trouble for using steroids, it's because they've been told that there's no other place but first place, And if you don't win the gold medal, you're nothing at all. That was not the sports talk message of the man who trained me, or of his contemporary and friend, Grantland Rice. And if their message seems corny in this age of superdomes and interminable playing seasons and million-dollar deals and cocaine busts and labor management disputes, it does not seem corny here, not tonight, and not on this team. For when the one great scorer comes to write against your name, he marks not that you won or lost, but how you played the game. That was the message of Grantland Rice. And there is this to say about overnight. It's the only place I can recite those lines with a straight face.
Why Children's Hospital?
At emergency, I'd come to Children's Hospital.
Because I know I'll get help immediately. I have the best doctors. And I get answers to all my questions.
Because one thing I notice about Children's is that if I have a case of emergency, the doctor is always on hand, and they can always answer my questions, and they take really good care of the babies here.
Well, I'm a medical student working there for this month, and I'm finding that it's a wonderful place where the nurses and the doctors and all the staff really care about the children.
I always think of Children's Hospital first because I think they do a great job, and they give a good treatment, and the nurses are great, and I think it's the perfect place to go when your child is sick.
Join us. We need your help. Contribute to Children's Hospital Fund, Box 1983, Cambridge, Mass. 02238.
Time, 5:30 p.m. What's about to happen in this car happens every evening during every drive home. An unexplainable change turns this normally calm businessman into a tense and aggressive driver, intent on tailgating instead of staying 2 seconds behind the car in front. Too bad. By following the 2-second rule, this could be avoided, and an otherwise nice guy could make driving a lot nicer and safer for everyone. Be street smart. Drive defensively.
I'm here at the Burlington Coat Factory to find out why women love shopping here.
There's super savings here. Very impressed with your designer collection.
The coats are fantastic. The sportswear department is really nice. They have name brand things at good low prices.
The prices are excellent. I would say they're probably almost half of what I see in the stores.
I've never seen this many coats before.
Okay.
Yeah. I just love it.
Saving selections in famous brands. That's what Burlington Coat Factory is all about.
Usually at this time, we show the week in review. Not this week. What follows was produced by our senior producer, Cheryl Gould. It was edited by Phyllis Famiglietti and Vinnie Novak of our staff. And the tough part, the plowing through 367 editions, that was done by Patty Lewis, also of Overnight. All the pictures are from this program. We began July 5th, 1982, with an eclipse of the moon. In case you're counting, tomorrow's Sunday, there is no moon at all. And we always began the week in review with a quote about the past. Tonight I choose one from William Shakespeare. The past is prologue. Roll it.
Tonight, to inaugurate our program, we bring you An Eclipse of the Moon. And what other program ever did that for you?
And if you want more, there is more. More news, sports, more news. The not ready for prime time news. Plus dragon boats, crocodiles, spaceships, and 1 billion Chinese, more or less. Welcome to Overnight.
Gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna set my heart at ease. Gonna make a sentimental journey to a new old memory.
There you are, Bob.
Take a coffee break?
Yes, my moon's... I was, in fact, taking a coffee break. I didn't know we were coming so soon. But this is a new show, and we're trying new things.
Over here, where were you?
I got my reservation. Spent each dime I could afford. Like a child in wild anticipation. Long to hear that horn.
Simply pull the trigger, is that all?
It's usually enough.
Seven, that's the time we leave.
At seven, I'll be waiting on.
For heaven.
Don Foster Dulles said...
George Santayana said...
Sir Wilfred Grenfell, an English physician, once said...
Willa Cather, an American author, said...
John Foster used to say...
George Eliot wrote...
Galileo wrote...
Cary Grant did not say...
I'm sorry, I was reading.
Did I hear right?
How they'll look by the end of the day, no one can guarantee.
Then, perhaps, the moon.
We have ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff, 32 minutes after the hour, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
11, clear.
I want to know what it felt like standing there. Did you feel a rumble inside? Is that, that's what they say. Did your diaphragm rattle?
It gave new meaning to the phrase, the earth moved.
Well, fancy that.
Resultados concretos.
Contenu de l'engagement personnel de Ronald Reagan.
Были сделаны предупредительные выстрелы трассирующими снарядами.
全部対象をしていると。そしてこの傾向が続くと84年の上院選挙では。
Correspondent Mary Nissenson is at the headquarters of Congressman Washington, the first black mayor of Chicago, and we will try to go there now.
Yes, go, go, go.
Gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna set my heart at ease. Gonna take a sentimental journey to renew old memories.
On a reel.
On a roll.
On a roll.
On a reel.
On a roll.
On a reel.
On a reel.
On a couple of slices.Lately, you may have noticed a bit of musical chairs being played on this program. But in three nights, I have spilled three cups of coffee because the coffee is where it should be, but I was not. So I have moved back, and if the executives don't like it, they may jolly well come and do the show and spill their own coffee.
And I want you to call the magic number today, 893-8100.
It's called the NBC News Guide to Central America, Central America in Turmoil. In these 16 thrill-back pages, all somebody thinks you need to know about those pesky southern countries that are making such big news.
Seven, that's the time we leave at seven. I'll be waiting up for heaven, counting every mile of railroad track that takes me back.
Live TV is a great time saver. It allows you to make a fool of yourself in front of large groups of people instead of one at a time.
Basketball. Excuse me.
The volunteers are... Excuse me.
And that is our week in review.
And the worst that can happen is that Lloyd and Bill and I keep moving around until all NBC News broadcasts end with, and so it goes.
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 Say amen.
All right. And so it goes.
Never thought my heart could be so yearning. Why did I decide to roam? Gonna take a sentimental journey.
Here comes the surprise ending we promised. I don't want to say this any more than I wanted to hear it. NBC has canceled overnight.
The final explanation came from Reuven Frank, the president of NBC News. He also happens to be one of the people who created this program. He said, quote, it was our finest hour of news and remains the model of an hour news program. But being the best is not enough.
Christmas gift from Radio Shack.
Joan, Radio Shack's Christmas electronics sale solved my gift problems. I got Jimmy two-way hi-fi speakers, half price, just $39.95 each. For Jeff, a realistic 40-channel CB, only $79.95. Mindy, a deluxe solar-powered 4-key memory calculator, $10.77. And I got this cordless phone, only $99.95.
A super Christmas electronics sale, only at Radio Shack.
When an alkaline battery goes dead, you throw it away and buy a new one. This is a GE rechargeable. When it goes dead, you recharge it. It costs more than batteries you throw away, but lasts up to 4 years. Use 10 hours a week, this toy would use over 300 long-life batteries to just two GE rechargeables. So if you're still throwing away batteries, you're throwing away a lot of money.
On First Camera, Nicholas Shadrin, the spy who never came back. It's a tale Robert Ludlum could have written, but it's true, about a Russian defector who became a double agent and then one day in Vienna disappeared. Did the KGB get him? Did the CIA set him up? Is he dead or alive? And find out what Melvin Dumar is doing. He's the man who claimed Howard Hughes left him $150 million. Also, klezmer music. It's old, it's new, it's cool, it's hot. First Camera, Sunday.
Sunday, more than 150 stars in two fantastic hours of TV's greatest moments. Steve Allen, Fred Astaire, Carol Burnett, Dick Clark, Sammy Davis Jr., Neil Diamond, Elvis, Judy Garland, Bob Hope, Lena Horne, Elton John, Janis Joplin, Michael Landon, Peggy Lee, Dean Martin, Paul McCartney, Shirley MacLaine, Ethel Merman, Marie Osmond, Patti Page, Dolly Parton, Dinah Shore, Frank Sinatra, Barbara Streisand, Ben Vereen, Stevie Wonder. Here's Television Entertainment Sunday.
Somewhere out beyond Pluto, way out beyond Pluto, float the signals of old television shows. That's because the waves never decay, they just go farther out, which means you could see anything you wanted. If you could get there, well, you can't. The waves are moving at the speed of light, and you can't do that. Happily, there is another way to get the job done. It's called the videotape library. Overnight's Ellen Harris found this treat in the drawer marked 1949. We don't know why.
Now let's have a look at a really charming aggregation of juvenile musicians. Yes, from Italy, here is the television debut of the hottest little jazz band on two continents, the youngest 7 and the oldest 11.
Time to talk about silk purses. Once we had a story about a pig in a truss. That, Lord knows, was bad enough. But to have the gall to reprise the pig in verse, well, that takes real courage. On the theory, however, that your body never outgrows its need for animal stories, here's one more. The Salzier Award to Greg Palmer of KING in Seattle, and once again, Iggy.
Somewhere mud is oozing, somewhere slops congeal, somewhere boars are snoozing as the sows begin to squeal. But here our hearts are heavier than a hog in a pickup truck. For Iggy, gentle Iggy, is a missing from the muck. It seems like only yesterday his story came to us of a plucky little porker in a tacky little truss. Just 3 weeks old you were then, but a foot from stem to sternia. But Ig, it moved us deeply to hear about your hernia. You didn't let it get you down. Your pig's feet never faltered. It was very hard to think of you as pickled, smoked, or altered. You were a lesson to us all with minds so tightly shut. Ignore those pains, you seem to say. Get out there and rut. But then the world came rushing in. We turned to distant shores. One trussed-up piglet can't compete with threats of nuclear wars. As we ignored him, Iggy grew. His hernia would heal. His tail curled, his hawk unfurled. There was timbre in his squeal. A giant hog was not to be, though. Iggy broke his leg. No little truss could help him then, or little wooden peg. The farmer had him put to sleep, then buried on the farm. But still beneath the mud he loved, he keeps our cold hearts warm. Greg Palmer for NBC News.
You must think you're the only one who has to call home five times a day because your wife drinks.
How you doing, honey?
The only one who rushes home at noon to make sure the kids get fed.
Bill, you're supposed to have lunch with a client today.
The only one who has to ask someone again and again to cover for you.
Okay, Bill, I'll do it.
But you're only one of the millions of people who know that you don't have to drink to suffer from alcoholism. At Al-Anon, we know how much it hurts. We're here because we've been there. Call us now.
It's the cashmere sweater. Looks expensive, but I paid only $59.75 at Burlington Coat Factory. Only $59.75 for 100% cashmere. Burlington made a fantastic buy from a very famous maker, so I got a fantastic buy. Had my pick of V-neck, crew neck, turtleneck, cowl neck. Bought one of each. At $59.75, who could resist? Burlington Coat Factory, a girl's best friend. Next to diamonds, of course.
Tears left. I was the first daughter in the family just to start college. Now I'd have to leave. Not because of my grades, but because of money. Even with a part-time job, I couldn't afford to go on. Mom and Dad wanted to help, but they were just getting by themselves. Now my dream was going to die. I'd never be a doctor.
When bright young minds can't afford college, America pays the price. But the United Negro College Fund can make the difference. We work to keep college affordable at 42 predominantly black colleges.
Thanks to the United Negro College Fund, today I'm Dr. Linda Doty White.
Support the United Negro College Fund. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
Here's the top story. The November figures were good. Unemployment fell to 8.4%. That's the lowest in 2 years. The Labor Department said that meant 740,000 people found jobs during November. The president and the president's men have attributed the drop to the president's policies.
And we have a bunch of items. In Peking Friday, dog owners were given a 3-week extension to kill their dogs. The mayor says dogs carry germs and has outlawed owning dogs. Said the Peking Municipal People's Government, from now until the extension runs out, we'll still try to conduct propaganda work so that the masses will willingly kill the dogs themselves.
And in Morristown, New Jersey, a salesman who pleaded guilty to molesting 3 young girls has been sentenced. The judge has ordered him to spend weekends in jail and to attend an off-Broadway play that the judge said would show him the terrifying experience it would be if he had to go to jail. The children who are molested do not, at least, have to go to the play. And finally, in 1975, when the Khmer Rouge took over Cambodia and drove the people out of the cities in order to turn the country into a primitive agrarian place, they also did away with television. 9 years later, today, Saturday, TV comes back to Cambodia. Missed it by that much.
Friday's weather included developments in all 50 states. For Saturday, we are assured the same will be true. If this is not sufficient detail, check the map. It was made by people just like yourself. They care. They want their work appreciated. Help them out. Look at the map. The art department thanks you, and we thank the art department. In some families, when they gather for a big event, one of the elders makes a speech. Other families, they have a big argument. This family, we look at our favorite piece of television. We're about to show it for the third time. It's probably because, in ways that words really don't deal with properly, we see some of our hopes in this piece, and what we hope to do here. Senior producer Cheryl Gould and videotape editor Maddie Powers put it together. Okay, the family's together. All the kids, even the loud cousins from out of state, have quieted down. Watch the pictures. Listen to the music.
Thank you.
Time for last words. For the last time, my turn first. Two important things happened here. One, it seems clear that you there and we here broke the barrier of the medium that connects us. We involved each other in the ideas that were this program. We showed there is more than one way to send and receive the news. The experiment succeeded. Will the technique spread? Let us all hope. Well, that's business. Let's talk about life. We were not afraid of each other's successes in here. When one of us grew, it did not mean that another had to shrink. There was plenty of room. The producers, editors, researchers, technicians, behind me and in a bunch of rooms on other floors and in other cities, were the sinew of what went on here. It is on their wings that this show flew, and together we went higher than any one of us could have reached alone. And our work was multiplied by a lot of things: love, respect, wisecracks, irreverence, bad and good taste, and a fair share of wisdom. It was a news show. It was a high time. It was one hell of a ride.
Before we leave, thank you. Thank you for the more than 10,000 letters, telegrams, and calls. And for the toys, flowers, books, records, songs about overnight, and the money which we sent back. What you said, we take with us. I think it's not as important that NBC took this program off the air as it is that NBC put this program on the air. That was something. We go smiling. The final quote is from Mark Twain, discussing the young missionary who went out among the cannibals. Said Twain, "They listened with the greatest of interest to everything he had to say, and then they ate him." This is the 367th edition of Overnight. There are no more. And so it goes. Good night.
Good night.
It was just one of those things, just one of those crazy flings, one of those bells that now and then ring. just one of those things. It was just one of those nights, just one of those fabulous flights, a trip to the moon on gossamer wings, just one of those things. It was just one of those things, just one of those crazy flings, one of those bells that now and then ring, just one of those things. If we thought a bit of the end of it when we started painting the town, we'd have been aware that our love affair was too hot not to cool down. So goodbye, dear, and amen. Here's hoping we meet now and then. It was great fun, but it was just
beautiful and backward. It's modern and mystical. It's enchanting and emerging. It's people and problems. It's a China you have never... A journey to the heart of China. An NBC white paper Wednesday.